Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at living by the Lord. Living by the Lord. And this is one of the, I call it the most profound blessings we get when we cross into the New Testament. Because God no longer desires that we live by ourselves. He has actually brought himself down to live through us. So the New Testament is about the believer's union with Christ. So right from Matthew to Revelation, there's just a central theme regarding the New Testament. That is the union of Christ with the believer. The union of Christ with his church, because we are now members of his body in the New Testament. We are his divine, we are the branches, he's the husband, we are the wives, and we are the wife, essentially. So we're looking at the union between the believer and the Lord Jesus Christ, and narrowing on living by the Lord, because we can live by our natural self, because we came from the old creation, from the old race of man, the Adamic nature. Now God's expectation for us is that we are not living by ourselves, but actually is the Lord living through us. So the Lord enters into us to be our life. So in the New Testament, one of the most profound or unique blessing is that God comes into us to be our very life and our very essence. He puts himself into us, and he also puts us into himself, which is what he meant in John 15 when he said, "Abide in me and I in you." And it's a general way to welcome one to the New Testament, because in the Old Testament, they didn't really have the full manifestation of this in the Old Testament. We don't see a mutual abiding, that is the living of the Israelites in God and God living in them. They were basically, was just types and shadows, that because the price had not been paid. He had to pay the price. He had to go through a process to make this a reality in our life. And what a joy that our living today is not by our natural life. God's expectation and goal for us is that we are not living by ourselves, but we are living by the indwelling Christ, the indwelling Lord, who is in us, working in us, both to will and to do for his good pleasure. This is what God had always intended to do. So God's good pleasure is that we are not living by ourselves. No man was created to live by himself. God never intended any one of his created man, his creatures, man, in respect to what we are looking at, to live by themselves. Why? Because he made us in his image and his likeness. And Colossians chapter 1 and Hebrews chapter 1 tells us that Christ is the express image of the Father. So God created us as a vessel, as a container, as a vessel, a means whereby Christ will be the person living in and through us. He never created us to live by ourselves. So one, a great shortage we have in life, or will I call it the greatest shortage in the human race, is just the shortage of Christ. It's the shortage of Christ. It's not that we are short of ethics, we're not short of good behaviors and all those things, because God's intention is that our greatest shortage in life is actually the living of the Lord in our lives. That's what we need every morning when we wake up. That's why he presents himself to us as food, as the air we breathe. He presents himself as drink. It's the true drink of life. He said, "Come unto me and drink." So he presents himself in the basic essentials of life. No human being can survive without air, without water, without food. And here's Christ now presenting himself to us. His goal is to let us know that without him, we cannot live the way God has designed it to live. So we have, as believers, we have the natural life and we also have the divine life. God's goal is that we are allowing the Lord, who is the life of God, to be the one living through our life. So we were created as vessels and containers for Christ to live in. That's our core calling as Christians. So whether, no matter the walk of life where you are in, as a father, a mother, husband, wife, whatever occupation you're doing, whatever area of ministry you're occupying, our core calling, in my opinion, is that we are allowing the Lord to live by us. No one can be a better husband than Christ. No one can be a better wife than Christ. No one can be a better parent than Christ. No one can be a better pastor, a better musician, a better engineer, a better lawyer, architect, dentist, pharmacist than Christ himself. So recognizing that fact actually makes us to narrow the scope of our living. unto him. He said, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. No one can pray acceptable to God aside from Christ. He's the one, is prayer himself, is the spirit of prayer. So we can see that everything we desire to do in life, our destiny, our calling, whatever name we want to call it, God's goal is that he should be the one living it, working it in us, both to will and to do for his good pleasure, so that he will get all the glory at the end of the day. So God never designed us to live by ourselves. So we look at a few scriptures, Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So he went through a lot of processes to make this a reality. Of course, for example, for us to be able to eat maybe a crop, a vegetable, a fruit, the seed has to be planted. After being planted, it's watered. Actually, the seed dies to the ground, now resurrects, now or comes alive to produce a lot of fruit. So the Lord went through a lot of processes to make this a reality. In his incarnation, he became a man. He lived as a man. Then he now died as a ransom for man and now resurrected to produce many grains, which we are is the outcome of. That's why I said in John 12:24, that except the grain of wheat fall to the ground and die, it abides by itself, but if it dies, it produces many grain. So we are no longer to live by ourselves in the New Testament. As believers, as Christians, God's goal for us is that daily we are putting to death the old man, that is the natural life, and we allow Christ to be the one living through us. It's not the easiest of things to live by another. That's speaking naturally. It's not easy at all. It's easy to live for someone. It's easy to live for Christ. It's easy to live for God, because what you're doing is that you're just trying to do something to appease God. I'm not saying they are wrong. 2 Corinthians 5 says that he died for us so that we will not live by ourselves but for him. But the deeper dimension which God wants or expects from us as believers is that we are not just living for Christ. We are actually living by Christ. We are living by the Lord, because it is as he is living in us that we are able to live for him. He has a lot of things he desires to accomplish through our life. He said, not by power, not by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. That's why in Philippians chapter 1, Paul said, for to me to live is Christ. It's a consciousness. It's not an easy thing to live by another. I keep repeating it. It's easy for a wife to live for the husband to live for the wife, but for them to live by the other person, it's impossible, humanly speaking, except the Lord comes inside of us and we give him the space to increase in our life. In John 10:10, he said, I have come that they may have life. And the life, of course, is himself. His life is not different from himself. Also, Christ, who is our life, Colossians 3, verse 4, that Christ, who is our life. So we can, it's all true in the New Testament. There are other scriptures we could even take a look at. He who feeds on me. This is John 6:57, that as the living Father sent me, and I live by the Father. So whoever feeds on me, whoever eats me, will live by me. That's just a very direct statement that God's intention for us as believers is that he wants to be the one living through our life. He wants to be the one living by us. But he now said, except we feed on him, we can't live by him. I can't live by the food I've not taken into my system, because when we eat, there's a mingling that exists between my system. There's a processing that goes, and the food becomes one with me. What my body doesn't need, it parts itself. But so God is now saying that when we feed on him, we give him the opportunity to come into us afresh to live through our life. So the more we feed on him, the more we are able to live by him. And here's 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Verse 5, Paul was talking to the church in Corinth, and which is to us, it's applicable to us, because the epistles are letters that we can say God is writing to us today. The word of God is ever fresh, it's eternal. He said, why do you seek for a proof of Christ speaking in me? Who is not weak in you, but mighty? Then he now went in verse 5 to say, do you not know yourself that Jesus Christ is in you? That is the consciousness. It's a consciousness, it's an awareness that the Lord has to help us to be able to be aware every day, when we wake up, with the reality or with the consciousness that, Lord, let my living today not be me living. Let me not be me speaking. Let me not be me doing any action. Let it be you walking through me. Let it be you manifesting yourself. And this is in Colossians chapter 1. From verse 26-27, said, to them God will to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. That is God's goal, which was hidden This was God's intention in eternity past, and yet it was hidden until in the New Testament era when God unveiled it to Paul to reveal the mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So our glory, or the glory of God being manifested in our life, is a function of how much of the revelation we have had of the Lord being revealed in us. Like he said in Galatians 1:15-17, he said, when it pleased God who separated me from my mother's womb to reveal his son in me. So there's a revelation that God wants to give to us as believers, that we are not the ones to do this living by ourselves, because it's almost impossible for a human being to try to fly like a bird, like an eagle. God has to come inside of us as our life, and we have to give him the room to manifest himself. He became a man to become our life. So we, here's God's desire to become our life, for the Lord to live inside of us, but we can't go up to meet with him because of our sinful condition of the transgression of the first Adam, of Adam. And now he had to now come, condescend himself to become a man. So his goal was to become our life, to live through us, but he can't just gatecrash, use that word reverently, into our hearts, because humanity was sold to the devil through the transgression of Adam. So he had to come in legally, and so he first had to become a man, which is the incarnation of Christ. Now he passed through death to become our life, which is dying as a grain of wheat, because the seed has to be buried, has to die for it to be able to produce many fruit. So he now resurrected as a life-giving spirit to become our life. From 1 Corinthians 15:45, that the first Adam was made a living soul, the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. So in his ascension, he is one spirit with us, but he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. What a great joy for this great privilege. I think it's the greatest asset, I would say, under heaven, the asset of having the Lord living through us, living by us, having the Lord being our very essence and element. He's in us to live through us. So it's not in us to be, it's not a passive God. He doesn't desire to just come into us like somehow we put furniture in our house for decoration purposes. That's not God's intention. That's not what the Lord intends. He actually wants to come in to be the very occupant and the one calling the shots in everything we're doing. He doesn't desire that I speak by myself. He doesn't desire that I live by myself. He doesn't desire that I even drive, even the mundane things, the ordinary things. God wants to be the very one that is the source of it. He doesn't desire that I speak to my wife in my own natural self. He doesn't desire that you speak to your spouse in your own natural self. He doesn't desire that even in our places of work, that whatever occupation we are doing that is adding value to humanity, God is the author of all wisdom. So whether it's in engineering, medical, God is the number one professional in every field. So his desire and his goal is that he wants to be the one acting through us. He wants to be the invisible force that is actually moving through his children. So in this, the love, this is 1 John 4, I think verse 9. In this, the love of God was manifested towards us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. That we might live through him. So God's goal was not just to send him to the world to die for us and to go back to heaven and for him to leave us here. No, his goal was to die for us, and having died, he now resurrected as a life-giving spirit. Now the Lord is the spirit who now lives in us to continue what he had started in the four gospels, or to continue what the Lord had ordained in eternity past. So it's a process, it's a journey, and it doesn't end on the cross. What finished on the cross was his earthly ministry. That was to take care of our redemption, to pay the price for our transgression in Adam. So after the cross, there's much more work that he's still doing, because now he now occupies, lives in us, makes his home in our heart, and now begins to regenerate us, to transform us, to conform us to his image, to sanctify us in every part of our being, because we are from the old creation. He has to now come to cause this transition from the old creation to the new creation, whereby our living will be the living of Christ. The Lord is in us that we would live by him. So he's not in us as a decoration. He's not in us as just some kind of a passive Lord. No, he's in us to walk mightily in us. Like Paul said in Colossians chapter 1, I think the last verse, he said, but him who walks mightily in me. So God's goal is to work himself mightily in us, because there's a lot of things he wants to do on the surface of the earth. There's a lot of things in every sphere of human endeavor that is adding value to life. It only takes God himself, the Lord, to carry out his desires. We are just glorified vessels. We are just a channel through which he's going to carry it out. He wants to be the one, the invisible force, the invisible being walking, but only through his children, so that all glory will go back to God. When men see our good work, they will glorify our Father who is in heaven. He became flesh to accomplish redemption as a Lamb of God. John 1:14, that the Word became flesh and tabernacled among us, and we beheld his glory. And 1 Timothy 3:16, that great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached to the Gentiles, and received them into the world. So to accomplish the redemption, because there are two sides, he needed to first take care of the issue of sin. That's the transgression of Adam, the negative. Now we now needed as well the positive to now come inside of us to now begin to continue his human living. So God's goal was not that in the four gospel that the Lord should come, perform a lot of miracles, manifest God in every environment where you went to. But God's goal was that he started with him. Now, upon his death and resurrection, that work still continues. That's why we are the continuation of Christ as believers, as Christians. We are the continuation of his work. He said in John 14, that greater work than this will you do, because I go to the Father. Where was the Father? The Father is in him and he's in the Father. And now he now says, he and the Father will come and make their home in us. So he was coming to bring us into the family of divinity so that they can continue their living. So he became a life-giving spirit in resurrection to live in us without becoming the spirit. This 2 Corinthians 3:17, that now the Lord is the spirit. Without becoming the spirit, there is no way, in my opinion, that he can come inside of us, because man is a spirit essentially. Zechariah chapter 12, we look at that. Zechariah 12:1 say that the burden of the Lord came upon me, that he who stretched out the heavens, formed the and laid the foundation of the earth, and formed the spirit of man within him. So God formed a spirit in man so that man would have a medium through which the spirit of man is a receptacle through which God now lives in man. And he had to become a spirit that gives life. In death and resurrection, he became a spirit that gives God a spirit before the incarnation of Christ, but the spirit of God could not give life. But now God now desires that upon death and resurrection, that's why the scriptures say that the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. He could not release that spirit into us, or the life of God into us, except through death and resurrection, which was what he was saying in John 12:24, that except he went through death. It's not waiting to be our life in the future. It's not waiting till the new Jerusalem or till our assignment here on earth is over, till before it becomes our life. He has entered into us today to be our very life today, because he still has a lot of things to do on the surface of the earth. So he's not just waiting to say that, okay, in the great, in the new Jerusalem, the holy city of the Lord, in the eternity future, it will be our life. No. The scriptures tell us a lot of it from the New Testament, that the Lord is our life. Christ, who is our life, in that Colossians 3:4, that Christ lives in me, that for me to live is Christ, that Christ is mighty in me, that Christ be glorified, Christ be magnified in our life. So he's not a distant savior, but an indwelling savior. A distant savior would mean that he's in heaven and we are by ourselves. Yes, he's in heaven. And at the same time, he's also in our hearts. How? Don't ask me. It's just the mystery of our Lord Jesus Christ. His omnipresence. Omnipresence is everywhere. That's why the church fathers came up with the term the pneumatic Christ. That is the Christ that fills everywhere with himself. From that Ephesians chapter 4, that he that ascended is the same that descended, and the one that descended is the one that ascended, that he might fill all things with himself. So that was his goal, to fill everywhere with himself. So there's no place where he's not. That's why he's our very present help in time of need. So he's not a distant savior, but an indwelling savior. Every minute someone will say, do we need him as our savior every day? Yes, we've been delivered from the powers of darkness from his, we've been translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of God's dear son. But there are a lot of things we still need to be saved from. We need to be saved from even our natural life, to be saved from anger, to be saved from pride, to be saved from works of the flesh, which are a lot of the epistles. You can see that a lot of in the Corinthian, the church in Corinth, and everywhere you can tell that the admonition was coming from the Holy Spirit, because we still need his daily salvation. Daily salvation, that is him walking in us to will and to do for his good pleasure, so that the old man will not be getting the better of us, so that we'll be manifesting the trait of the new creation. The genuine Christian life is the living of the Lord within us. In my opinion, that the genuine, the original, the authentic one, I believe, is just the Lord living within us. God doesn't, I don't think God desires that I love my neighbor by in my natural life, that through my natural old Adamic life. That is how I'm actually praying to God, because the source is always very important, because someone could be praying, but the prayers could be just, soaked in covetousness. You could be doing good, but God's desire is like, look, I don't want the tree of knowledge of good and evil. From the beginning, I've said, eat of the tree of life. And the tree of life is just a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. So God is saying that it's not a function of whether what I'm doing is good or bad per se. But God is looking at it that who is actually the one living in me? Who is living through me? What is the source, or who is the source, or who's the driving force of what I'm doing? So sometimes we can take a classical case in the book of Acts chapter 16. Here was Paul and his crew. They were going to preach in Asia. That is a good work. But they realized the fact that they are living by the Lord, and they were forbidden by the Spirit of Jesus Christ not to go to Asia. If they were to live in their natural abilities, they just go. It is good. Let's go do it. But not to God are his ways. But he said, no. And all of it again, they said they wanted to go to Bethany, and said, no, the Spirit did not allow them. Now, they now saw a vision of a man calling them to Macedonia, and they now went. So, if we are living in our own natural, if they were living in their own natural abilities, they will have just jumped and gone to Asia. More than likely, they'll be out of the will of God. So it's not so much, and to preach is a good thing, to pray is a good thing. I'm not saying we don't do those things, but God's goal is that we should not be the one doing it in our natural life, in our natural self. That each time those opportunities present themselves, Lord, what are you saying? Is this the right door? Is this you moving? If you are not the one, just don't take away the desire. Close the opportunities, because there's no point trying. Why should I be trying to impress God in my own natural self? He said all our righteousness is filthy rags before him. So we are not saying we don't do good, but what I believe the scripture is saying is that allowing the Lord to be the very source, even when I want to do good, even when I want to give, even when I want to do a good act, something in me should be reminding me that I am of the new creation. God's goal for me is that he wants to be the one doing it through me. So it's not that's why it's not every blind person that the Lord Jesus Christ healed in the four Gospels. He didn't heal everybody. He even passed through some that were sick, and until some even called him, like blind Bartimaeus. He saw them there, even in John chapter 5, in the pool of Bethesda. He saw a lot of lame, but he only went to one person, because that is actually what the Father wanted to do. So he lived by the Father. He desires the same for us. We're not saying we don't do good, but we're just saying that any good we want to do, we should just make sure that we have a check, a green light from the Lord, that is actually what he wants to do in that purpose. That's the temptation that came to him in the wilderness during his fasting, when the devil came to him that, hey, look, turn these stones to bread. You might say that's a good thing. You're turning something to something that is edible. But he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So I am the vine, and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. It doesn't mean that we don't do something. We do something, but it will amount to nothing. And so our prayer is that the Lord should give us the grace to abide in him, to see him as our very essence, because everything the branch desires in life is coming from the vine. The branch, every of its source, its nutrient is coming from the vine. So that's abiding, and that union has to remain intact for a continuous flow of every grace the vine carries. He wants to love, pray, give, and dispense himself to the world through us. So his goal is that he wants to touch the world, but he's not going to touch the world like an invisible force or invisible spirit. He's going to do it through us, his children, through his believers. But we have to now give him the opportunity. We have to open up our life, give him the space to come inside of us to carry out his good pleasure. Not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. And 2 Corinthians 4, that, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. So God's goal continuously, we see it all through the scripture, is that we are not the ones to be living. We are not the ones to live this Christian life. It's a challenge, a big challenge, if we are going to use our natural human life to try to live the divine life. It's almost like asking a monkey to come and fly like an eagle. No matter how much the monkey is trying to fly, the more it mimics an eagle, the more laughable it becomes. And we are not acting drama in the Christian life. I mean, there are good dramas, and when we talk about, I'm talking in the sense of trying to be what we are not. In this context of what we're looking at, when our natural life is trying to do what only God can do. And many a time it's just because we want to take pride and boast in our ability to do something. Oh, look at the number of, I prayed for 7 hours this day. Oh, I won 8 souls. Those things are blessed and good, as long as it is the Lord that is doing it through our life. If it is the Lord, rarely are we going to boast against our neighbor, because we just realize that we are just earthen vessels, that all glory should go to him. Amen. So God's eternal plan has been to work himself into his chosen people to be their life, so that they may be his expression on the earth. So that's God's goal, to be our life, so that we could express him on the surface of the earth. And God will stop at nothing. God will take a break at nothing to see that this is fulfilled. He made us in his image and his likeness so that he could live his divine life through our life. Philippians 2:13, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. So in eternity past, God made this plan that he was going to create people, and out of this, he chose us, he predestined us in Christ, Ephesians chapter 1, Ephesians chapter 2 as well, so that we'll be in union with Christ, so that he could be our life and we could express him. There's no way we could express him except he comes inside of us to live through us. Except, I mean, any other thing would just be, we're just trying to be actors and actresses, because God has to be the very same person in us living that divine life, because the divine life is beyond anything of the natural abilities. He did not only die to redeem us, he resurrected as a life-giving spirit to live in us. So he didn't just die to redeem us alone, but he also resurrected as a spirit that gives life. In that 1 Corinthians 15:45, the last Adam became a life-giving spirit, but he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. He needed to go through this, or else there will be no way for him to come into our hearts legally. Because after Adam fell, our hearts, I mean, the spirit of man was dead in him, because that's the receptacle God had created to fellowship with man. So he needed to go through that process. On going through the process of dying to redeem us, he now came back as a spirit that gives life, that now lives in us, walking in us, and reaching the world through our lives. So we are just vessels of mercy, sheer vessels of mercy. So our risen Lord today is not only in heaven, but also making his home in our heart. So our risen Lord today is not just a distant God that is in heaven. He's not a distant Savior in heaven alone, but he's living right in our hearts, so that our life will be a blessing to anyone we come across. He made man in his image to live in him. So part of the reason he created man is that so that we could live in him. That was his original goal. That was his intention, so that man will actually live by the risen Lord. And in doing that, he created the structure, the template for man to live in. So he formed the spirit within man as a receptacle to receive him. Zechariah chapter 12 verse 1 says that the burden of the Lord, and that he who stretched out the heavens, laid the foundation of the earth, and also formed the spirit of man within him. So our spirit was created as a receptacle to be a container that receives God, that the spirit of God dwells in. And what a joy. So it's not just in heaven. is in heaven and at the same time is in our hearts, because our heart has now become a legal place, a receptacle that can receive the Lord. That's why I said, if you take away the heart of the stony heart and give us the heart of flesh so that it can live inside of us. What a blessing and joy. Our entire life and whole being are an outward shell. When God himself enters into us, he becomes our content in order to fill every part of our being with himself. So we are just but like a shell. The goal of us as being a container is more or less for us to carry a specific content, and this content has got to be the risen Lord himself. So outwardly, we are but a shell. Inwardly, the Lord is our content. So outwardly, we are a shell. Inwardly, the Lord is our very content. He's living in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure. What a great joy. What a great joy. So the most wonderful aspect of our salvation is having and allowing the Lord to live through us. I believe that's one of the greatest blessings of our salvation. Allowing the Lord to live in and through our lives. Because the joy is that we are not just another human being on the surface of the earth trying to do certain things to be very successful, trying to do something to be better than other fellows. But no, we are here on an assignment. That our assignment, the core part of our assignment, is like asking the Lord, that like Paul said in I think Acts chapter 9, that Lord, what would you have me to do? There are many things we want to do in our own natural abilities, and sometimes we think that the more good, like the people of the world think that the more good they can do, the more maybe they will be able to make it to heaven and spend eternity with God. But God is saying that, look, that's still the knowledge of good and evil. I don't want you to eat of that tree. I want you to eat of the tree of life, which is a type of the Lord. The type of the reality is the Lord of the tree of life. Because let's take, for example, in Acts chapter 16, verse 6 to 7, Paul and his crew wanted to go to Asia to preach. To preach is a good act, right? But the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord, forbid them. And they, again, they wanted to go to Bethany. The Spirit of the Lord forbid them. Until maybe the third time, now they got a vision, the Macedonian call, and they now felt, okay, leading, this is where the Lord is going to. So sometimes in ourselves as believers, we are tempted to think that we can just do whatever, if it appears to be good, then it's an okay thing from the Lord. But no, I think the Lord is saying that I want to be the one doing the good through you. So to preach to Paul and his company, it was a good thing, but it wasn't in the will of God for them to go to Asia. So it's not every good thing that appears to us as believers we jump into. And the Lord is saying that I want to be the very source, the driving force for any decision that you're making, that I'm making. And it's not the easiest of things, especially for our human flesh, because we are used to probably doing things by ourselves without probably consulting God. Now we come into the new creation, and God is saying that I'm the one to call the shot here in every detail, no matter how insignificant it might appear. To the Lord, he wants to be very interested. That's why he has come inside of us. So his salvation does not go from outside to inside, but from inside to outside. That is, it's not from the second frames to the center, but from the center to the second frames. And so from our hearts to every part of our being to spread. The first part is to capture the heart. He said that these people draw near to me with their mouths, but their heart is far from me. He said it's acceptable if anyone gives me first, there must be a willing heart. So God is always after the heart, the heart, the heart. It's not really the external actions. God is looking at the motive, the source of whatever action we're doing. So that's why he's living in us, that he wants to be the one working that in us. So whatever God has not worked in me, I don't try to just do something to please and impress God. Just imagine a monkey trying to impress an eagle that he can fly. The more he tries to mimic an eagle, the more laughable he becomes. So living by the Lord is the greatest blessing, but this could be very bothering to our human flesh. It could be bothering. If you're living by yourself, it's okay, it's no problem. But the moment you have a visitor and person coming in, now you're kind of restricted. You can't do as much as you want to do. So you now see, in the case of the Lord coming to live inside of us, it's very bothering to our human flesh, because daily our flesh is being put to death by the Lord. He's not doing it as a punishment to us, but it's so that he can release the divine life in him through our life. So certain things that the work of the flesh, maybe someone, certain things that are not productive to us as believers, and having the Lord come inside of us to live through us is going to sanctify. That's one of the key parts of sanctification, that is separating us from that which is common. And what it does there is that it works the desire in us to hate what he hates, to like what he likes. You just want to pray. You just want to praise him. It's not of our own human will. It's because the Lord is working that in us. But the more we feed on him, the more we fellowship with him, the more those desires increase and increase. So daily we take up our cross and deny the cravings of our flesh. We take up our cross and follow him. And so that, and we see that from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, because certain things that we don't think that we are going through those painful experiences without a reward. It says that always bearing, this 2 Corinthians chapter 4, always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. That is, as we bear about the dying of the Lord, God is saying that the life of Christ will be made manifest through our life. And for we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. That the life of the Lord will be made manifest in our mortal flesh. And what a joy. So it's not just we doing the living, that there's a reward that is coming for. So reading ahead, therefore, do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. So even though the outward man is perishing, but God is saying that as we allow the Lord to live, the inward man is being renewed day by day. It's daily, moment by moment. Lord, be the source of my living. If whether you're in a board meeting, you're in anywhere you are, even that silence prayer, even in your heart, the Lord, yes, Lord, we are going for this meeting, what to speak, what to say, how to react, just be the one doing it through my life. And as simple as that prayer is, to just allow the Lord is always faithful to honor the word of our prayer. So for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal glory. What a joy for what the Lord has done. So this Ephesians chapter 3, that he will grant us according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man, that the spirit in our inner man will be strengthened so that Christ will make his home in our hearts, that we may be able to comprehend the length, the depth, the breadth, the height of the love of God towards us, and so that we might be filled with all the fullness of God. So as we allow the Lord to live his life through our life, will be filled with every fullness of God, because Christ is the wisdom and the power, is the power and the wisdom of God, the glory of God. All the divine attributes dwell in Christ, is the embodiment of the Godhead. So every virtue in God is embodied in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So God wants him to live through us so that those virtues will be manifested to our world. So only by him living in us can our old man be displaced. Stories will not take away the old man, because the old man, the nature, the Adamic nature is ingrained in every man born of a woman. You don't even have to teach babies or kids lying. Sometimes they just lie and you're like, well, where they get it? They've not been going to a lying class or watching things that are telling them to lie, but it's just in everything, everyone born of Adam. It takes only the Lord to displace that monster out of our life. So the human will is never an easy thing to subdue. Only the Lord can. Philippians 3:21, it says that by him who is able to subdue all things to himself. And so his indwelling, though hidden and very mysterious, is the secret of the Christian life. It's hidden, it's mysterious, but that is the secret of the Christian life. I'm learning this as well. I've never dare come tell you that I've perfected the art of living by the law, but it's a process we are all going through. I don't think anyone will ever get to the zenith of it to say that they've known everything of living by the law, because it's just transforming us from glory to glory. And the more we are aware about it, the more we'll be more inclined to cooperate with his working in our life. Sometimes you want to say some things and maybe someone provokes you, and there's a inner nudging, just hold your peace. I mean, the more we cooperate with those leading, the more we see the manifestations of those life through our life. But if we are not aware, I mean, if we don't know that we have him in us as our life, not just as our life, but for him to live through us, we'll be trying to do only what God can do. We'll be trying to impress God. And God is saying that, do I with you, you're trying to impress me. Let me come inside, do what impresses me by myself, so that I will be the only one that will get the glory at the end of the day. So because he lives in us, he calls us his house, Hebrews 3:6, that he calls us his house, the house of the Lord, and he calls us his temple, 2 Corinthians 6:16, he calls us his branches, he calls us his body. So you can see, and there are probably a lot of other expressions he uses to describe, allegories the Lord uses to describe us, but I mean, for the sake of our time, but the joy is that his house means that he lives in us. That means they should ask him for his address on the earth. He will point to you and I, his believers in Christ, that is my house. This is the confidence that we have because he is living inside of us. He calls us his temple. He calls us his branches, that is the vine. We are the branches. We are the ones that manifest the fruits. And he calls us his body because we are his expression on the surface of the earth here. What a joy. So today we've been able to look at living by the Lord. And we said that this is God's goal in eternity past, that the New Testament is about the believer's union with Christ. The believer's union with Christ, that the Lord entering into us to be our life is the very center of the New Testament. And this is what makes us different. He puts us into himself and he puts himself into us. And what a joy. He said that abide in me and I in you. So we said that God's goal in eternity past has always been that we should not be the one living by ourselves. He didn't create any man. He didn't create man to live by himself. He created man in his image and likeness. And the image and likeness of God is just Christ. So he created us in his image and likeness so that Christ will live his life through our life so that we'll be a blessing to the world. But for him to be able to do this, he needed to become a man to become our life. He needed to pass through death to become our life. He needed to resurrect as a spirit that gives life to become our life. And in his ascension is one spirit with us. Why do we need the Lord to be our life? Because God, only God can attain his destiny for our life. Only God can carry out the thing he has ordained for us to do. He said, greater works than this shall we do. How are we going to do greater works if the one that did the greater works is not the one that will live through us? He himself did not live by himself doing his earthly ministry. The Lord Jesus did not live by himself. He said that I am with the Father and the Father is with me. I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Say that I can of my own self do nothing. So he said, living Father sent me, I live by the Father. So whoever eats me shall live by me. So the same standard which he had with his Father is the same standard he's having with us, that we should not be the one living. No matter what we want to do, whether it's good or it's something that whatever ethics things, God is saying that let me be the one doing it. Let me be the driving force. Let me be the one singing through you. Let me be the one evangelizing through you. Let me be the one in the boardroom. Let me be the one on the Senate. Let me be the one on the marketplace manifesting myself in that world. And what a joy. That's the burden we have, our calling as Christians, is that we are vessels, we are containers for the Lord to carry out his living. We said it could be very bothering. It's a blessing to live by the law, but it could be very bothering to our human flesh. Because a lot of things that we are used to, there's the tendency not to want to do away with such things. But the joy of it is that we bear about in our body the dying of the Lord daily, so that the life of the Lord Jesus Christ could be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So that wherever we go, we just radiate the fragrance of Christ in every environment. So it calls us many things, allegories, that we are his house, we are his temple, we are his branches, we are his body, because he's living in us. What a joy for what the Lord has done. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! Hallelujah!